drove a Cadillac. Well, 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 Elvis Pete had it all. They say he was the king. But look how happy he was when he split the scene.
Yeah, we need him. We need some strategies. Some strategies for living. So are you ready? You ready for your daily dose of radio rehab?
I'm ready. Are you ready?
Oh, have I got strategies for you this evening?
I was talking to Lauren.
Oh, yeah, I'm ready. Okay. I'm strapped in.
I jumped the gun tonight.
Just ignore me, okay? What am I, chopped liver? Hey, folks, welcome into 101.7 FM 710 Keel. Welcome into another edition of Strategies for Living. I'm Dr. David McMillan. He is Jimmy Bryant, PhD. That means he produces, he hosts, and he directs.
And I got to try and keep you on your toes.
And I'm trying. you got a big job.
It's like a beautiful ballerina.
And PLPC Lauren Leon McMillan. And yes. We do have a great program today. I love history. You know that?
Oh, me too.
Mm-hmm. I especially love wonderful history teachers and professors. I was so blessed all throughout, starting, I guess, with my seventh grade American history teacher, Mrs. Georgiana Scott, at Christ the King School in Bossier City.
Yeah.
And then, I had some good history teachers at Jesuit, but I had some great history teachers in college. I had Hubert Humphreys. Mm. And as a matter of fact, our friend Dr. Cheryl Scott is the Hubert Humphreys professor.
Oh.
Yeah, at LSU Shreveport. And I also had a guy named Jim Miller who was, and what I loved about Mr. Humphreys and Mr. Miller is they were storytellers.
Mm. Yeah.
They were storytellers.
Yeah.
I had a wonderful weirdo you might have heard of.
Yeah, I know the weirdo you're talking
Trudeau.
About. Yeah,
Trudeau. That.
Mr. Trudeau was, a wonderful teacher. Well,
and also a storyteller.
And a storyteller. We've got a storyteller here on Strategies this evening. She's also a professor, Joyce Lee Malcolm. She's the author of The Tragedy of Benedict Arnold. And her newest book, we're going to talk about it. It's The Times That Try Men's Souls. The Adams, the Quincy's, and the Battle for Loyalty in the American Revolution. You know, I didn't realize it. I really never thought about it until opening up Professor Malcolm's book. The Revolutionary War was a civil war.
Mm-hmm.
And it split families.
Mm.
It split friends. And, you know, here I've practiced 30 years as a family therapist, and I love history, and I missed this. And I totally missed it. And so I can't wait for our life strategist this evening, Joyce Lee Malcolm. Folks, thank you. Thank you for tuning into Strategies. We appreciate you being here, and we appreciate our sponsors making it possible. The Robinson Film Center and Azalea Cleaners. And Pintail Roofing.
Roof.
And Learning RX. And Hempress Cannabis with Love. And the Shreveport Little Theater. Back in a moment. Joyce Lee Malcolm. The Times That Try Men's Souls. That's today. Right here on Strategies.
Reading begins not in the classroom, but in your child's brain. I'm Donisa Walker with Learning RX Shreveport. If your child struggles to read, maybe he or she has trouble focusing or comprehending, LearningRx Shreveport offers a science solution to reading problems, working one-on-one with your child, targeting his or her reading skills. Today, call LearningRx Shreveport. Make an appointment to have your child assessed. I know you want to help your child. So does LearningRx Shreveport.
And welcome in. Welcome into 101.7 FM, 710 Keel. Welcome into Strategies for Living. Jimmy Bryant, PLPC, Lauren Leon McMillan, David McMillan. Let's welcome into the program now Joyce Lee Malcolm. She is an emeritus professor at Antonin Scalia Law School, George Mason University. She's the author of Guns and Violence, Peter's War, To Keep and Bear Arms, and The Tragedy of Benedict Arnold. Her new book, it's just out. It's called The Times That Try Men's Souls. Joyce Lee Malcolm, Professor, welcome to Strategies for Living.
Welcome.
Well, thank you so much for inviting me. It's a pleasure to be among people who enjoy history so much.
Oh, man. I think I missed the boat, Professor. I think if you'll take me back, I think I'll go back and we'll try this again.
There are a lot of people who just do history because they like it, not because they're in the profession. So you can always do.
Amen. You know, all wars are tragic. But I just never thought about, you know, and I guess there's a lot of us that don't think about our Revolutionary War. I mean, we get so caught up in the other stories, right?
Yes.
We don't think about how it split families, friends, acquaintances in your community. I mean, and it just struck me, wow, I never thought about that.
I know. I think most people just assume if you talk about divisions between families and friends that you're talking about the American Civil War. But actually, the Revolutionary War had a tremendous amount of that kind of tragedy, with husbands abandoning wives and children and friends not seeing each other again. There were some fled to England while others stayed in the U.S., fighting a war that they might very well have lost.
Yeah.
So it was, I was looking at it to see if I could get a sense of what it was like on the ground, the stories of people's lives at the time. And I found a lot more of this kind of division, and intimidation and violence between sides than I expected. So it's full of stories, but there are a lot of really quite tragic ones.
So you concentrate on the Adams, the Quincys, and the John and Abigail Adams. Were the Quincys related? I know John's Adam's son was John Quincy Adams.
Yes.
So is there a family relationship here?
Yeah, they all lived in the town of Braintree, which was south of Boston, and knew each other. It involves a lot of other people, friends of theirs and families as well. But I sort of started by focusing on them. And one of the things that got me interested in the Quincys was that in this very famous trial of the soldiers at the so-called Boston Massacre who had shot several people, four were killed, I guess, and seven wounded. At that trial, the government, the British government, had the older Quincy brother, Samuel Quincy, prosecuting the soldiers. Because it was interesting to have the British actually prosecuting their own soldiers.
Right.
Defending them was John Adams and a younger Quincy. So these two brothers were sort of on opposite sides in the courtroom. And the older one was a solicitor general working for the government. And the younger one, Josiah Jr., was a son of liberty. Hmm. And once I saw that, I thought, wow. and got into the papers and letters of those families and their friends. And in John Adams' case, his very best friend, a man named Jonathan Sewell, who had trained with him at the same judge's office, and they had traveled together. They were very close friends. Sewell was working for the government, and Adams, of course, was not. And Sewell tried to persuade Adams not to go to the Continental Congress, and Adams said it was too late. He intended to live or die with his country. And Sewell ends up eventually going into exile. And Sewell's wife is the sister of the wife of John Hancock.
Wow.
So here are all of these founders, and their families are split and writing letters happily, because that's how I was able to get more information about them, but writing letters back and forth. So it really gives you a sense of what it was like for those who stayed in the colonies and fought, and for those who went into exile, and what their lives were like as what they as absentees.
And you know, I guess we don't appreciate. I mean, we're dealing with here were you know, here we were going up against the greatest empire since Rome, huh?
Yes. A tremendous, and with, you know, large numbers of troops and a powerful navy. So, you know, if you had to think about who was likely to win, for certain you wouldn't have picked the colonists.
Right.
But so it, and we were lucky, actually, that the French helped us. We probably by ourselves we might not have managed to do it. But I think that those people who fled to England to get away from the intimidation and violence, and I can tell you more about that later, but thought for certain that the war would be really short and they would be safe.
Yeah.
And so they fled not having any idea of how long they were going to be in exile, what it would be like, would they blend in, you know, to the English society, how they would live and have enough finances to be in England, writing back and forth, you know, to the family back home.
And you mentioned Samuel Quincy. Of course, Samuel was a crown official, but here he was in the middle of this fiercely anti-British family. So again, the family, the family dynamics, as I
talk
about the drama triangle and talk about family systems. I mean, I spent 30 years as a family therapist. And so, you know, that's what really struck me as I was reading, Professor, your, you know, wow, the family dynamics here. It must have been extremely difficult, you know.
Yes, well, there were three brothers. The oldest one, Edmund, had died of a disease called a pulmonary disease. And that left Samuel, who was the second oldest, and that's his younger brother, Josiah, who was something of a hothead, actually. But you know, he was always writing these protests and saying that people should seize their arms right away and you might have to die for it.
Right.
You know, he actually had to be quieted down by the likes of Samuel Adams, who was a hothead himself. But his older brother, Samuel, was very paced. He liked luxury. He lived well. He had nice government posts. You know, he had a mansion in Boston, a wife and three children. But she was a patriot, and so were his, you know, the rest of her family and the rest of his family. And
That may be made for some chilly bedroom talk.
Yeah, it did. Well, the thing is, one of the things that surprised me was that he must have been one of the only people who went into exile thinking that he was going to prosper from it. He was a lawyer, and you know, and he kept thinking that there would be some opportunities if he went to England. And then he was quite shocked because his wife didn't want to accompany him. You know, it was, and his father was furious, and his wife and three children were really taken in by his brother-in-law, who lived in Cambridge and who raised those children as his own, really took care of. And Samuel left saying, "I'll be back soon. All this will be fine."
Right.
And
again,
and
thinking
course,
that this is not going to be a long drawn out affair. Again, the greatest empire since the Roman Empire. We're going to finish this real quickly.
Mm-hmm. Right. And I'll be on the right side.
Yeah.
I will be in it. I will have gone over to the right side. And
and
I think everybody always thinks a war is going to be short. You know, and they're always a lot longer than you think they're going to be. And this was certainly the case. And so the people that went abroad and fled, as I say, didn't know how long they were going to be there, didn't make any plans, just fled for their safety. And there were reasons why they had to flee, because there was a lot of intimidation. Once the Sons of Liberty got started, you know, protesting the Stamp Act, they actually, some of them, organized a mob of 3,000 people to go through Boston parading with the man who was the head of this collecting stamps for the government, this tax, in effigy, and they hanged him in effigy. And that wasn't good enough. They went to his house and they tore it apart. They went on after that to the house of Samuel Hutchinson, who seemed in general to be a nice guy. His family had been in public service in Massachusetts for years. And he had this lovely house. And I just say, they stripped it completely. He fled and his family fled because they heard this mob was coming.
Right.
They smashed in the doors. They pulled off the molding. They actually cut down the partitions within the house. They took the tiles off the roof.
Wow.
I mean, jeez.
And cut down his trees. And, you know, that was persuasive. It did persuade a lot of people who had taken on government posts to collect stamps that maybe they didn't want to do it.
I'd say.
But it was really bad because once you start a mob going, I mean, I think that Samuel's younger brother, Josiah, who was a son of liberty, was a lawyer, and he didn't like this kind of wildness. I think there were a lot of more sober-minded men and women in who didn't like to see mob action like that. Mm-hmm. But once you start a mob going, it's very hard to stop it.
Yeah.
And it did achieve what they had wanted, but it was at a high cost.
Yeah. We are we're talking today with the author of The Times That Try Men's Soul. Some people say that's now, but Professor Joyce Lee Malcolm says, "Oh no, it was back a few years ago. The Adams, the Quincy's, and the battle for loyalty in the American Revolution." When we come back, you know, you've got a chapter on fathers and sons, and I found something out in your book that surprised me. I want to talk about it when we come back. We think we know Benjamin Franklin and all about Benjamin Franklin, but Benjamin Franklin had a son that maybe we don't talk a whole lot about. And we'll talk about it with Professor Joyce Lee Malcolm when we come back here on Strategies for Living. But I want to talk a little bit about Robinson Film Center. Mm. Abby Singer's Bistro, newly renovated and open right now. Why don't we go this weekend?
You mean it? Let's go.
Yeah, let's go.
I'm ready.
Okay, I mean, and there's some great stuff, of course, always. The 2024 Oscar-nominated short films are playing right now at the Robinson Film Center, along with Maestro. And, you know, this is the thing about the Robinson. You get things like the Oscar-nominated films. You get films like Maestro, 7 Oscar nominations, including Best Picture, love story that chronicles the relationship of conductor composer Leonard Bernstein.
Yeah.
And, you know, so, you know, it's, man, there's just no place like the Robinson. I say that over and over. 6-17.
And we can't forget Cine Noir.
Cine Noir.
That's right.
Yeah.
Started tonight.
Kicks off tonight.
Yeah, absolutely. Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Okay. You can keep up with all of this at robinsonfilmcenter.org. And there's so many reasons to do that. So many reasons to become a member of the Robinson Film Center. So join the crowd. You get discounts on movies. You get concession upgrades. You get bistro deals. And you get to support a place that makes Shreveport-Bossier City, our entire area, better through film.
That's right.
Robinson Film Center. No place like it. RFC, 617 Texas Street, downtown Shreveport. RobinsonFilmCenter.org.
Hi, this is Jay Merle for Pintail Roofing. Let's talk about quality. When you hire Pintail to build your roof, here's what you can expect. Quality and quality control are the most important concerns for us at Pintail, and you need to know that Pintail stands tall with swift and professional performance on any warranty call. This is our most important policy. And remember, we're your neighbors. We'll be here for you for the long haul. Our family's lived here for over 100 years, and we aren't going anywhere. On the commercial side of Pintail's business, our fluid-applied roofing solutions can save thousands of dollars over conventional commercial roofing options. Call Pintail at 226-ROOF for a free inspection of your home or commercial building. That's 226-7663. Pintail Roofing. What's the condition of your roof?
And welcome back. Welcome back into 1017 FM, 710 KEO. Welcome back into Strategies for Living. Jimmy Bryant, PLPC, Lauren Leon McMillan. I'm David McMillan with Professor Joyce Lee Malcolm. the author of The Tragedy of Benedict Arnold, along with a lot of other books, To Keep and Bear Arms, Guns and Violence, Peter's War, and this new book, The Times That Try Men's Souls. You know, The Tragedy of Benedict Arnold, your book in 2018, yeah. We think we know, you know, Benedict Arnold, the traitor, right? We think we know all about Benedict Arnold. But when you read your book, you find out, well, you know, that little snippet that we got taught, there's so much more, isn't there?
He was a brilliant general. He was, in fact, the man who wrote the classic history of the British military said that he was the best general on either side in the American Revolution.
Wow.
He was just amazing and very brave. You know, he, as one of his soldiers said, he didn't tell you, go boys. He said, come boys. I mean, he was there at the front.
Yeah.
And, you know, so it really was a tragedy that he's become this two-dimensional character because he was really brilliant. And really won the Battle of Saratoga for us, which was the kind of turning point in the war.
Yeah, yeah.
And that's the thing about history and the work that you do, which I'm appreciative of, you know, is showing the full story, you know, that we're all humans and we all have very multi-layered...
His story.
Right, his story, the full story.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, it was not easy to get through the layers of history that had been written after he changed sides because they then went back and decided that he had been a really nasty child. And there was someone who wrote that what he did was that he liked to take little baby birds out of their nests and torture them in the sight of their parents.
Oh,
I thought, my God, how can you believe that?
Yeah.
You know, who could be that nasty? So there's this layer that, you know, people see a person, you know, by the final story, and they don't take a look at how they got that way or what else they had done.
The victors, whoever the victors happen to be,
get to write
his story.
Yes.
So it's interesting. I did not realize, again, the snippets that you hear, we think we know people like Benjamin Franklin. I didn't realize that until your book, Professor, that Benjamin Franklin's son was active and actually didn't see eye to eye with his dad completely?
Not at all. The Quincy's, Senior Quincy, had this embarrassment of his son, you know, being a loyalist. Benjamin Franklin was far better known. He had the one son, William, and was very close to him. And Benjamin Franklin wrote an autobiography, which he dedicated to William.
Yeah.
So they were very, very close.
Yeah.
And yet, you know, when the war broke out, William was the loyalist governor for New Jersey.
Right.
And remained there until he was finally, you know, kind of captured and put in under house arrest. Mm-hmm. They sent him to New York. They had this system called parole, which was sort of the origin of our parole system. You would be sent to a place like that on the promise that you would not get involved in the fight again. You would just sort of be neutral.
Okay.
And they sent him to New York, which was governed by the British for most of the war.
Right.
But he wasn't neutral. He got involved. He was constantly agitating and doing things and sabotaging his father's cause. And then when the British finally evacuated New York at the end of the war, he went with them. So he went back to, he went to England, and that's where he stayed. And did he and his father
make peace with each other after the war?
Well, I wouldn't say they actually, I would say they had a speaking relationship, and I wouldn't have called it close. William had one son too, Temple, and he became Benjamin's secretary. But at any rate, Benjamin went to Britain on a diplomatic mission and saw William there, and he needed to go over with him what the legacy was going to be in his will, and he basically told William, and this is when the war was over, that basically wasn't doing anything. William was upset, and he said, look, you know, if you had won the war, I wouldn't have had anything to give you.
Yeah.
So that was, but how embarrassing, you know, to be such a prominent founder, and then to have this one son who he loved very much,
Yeah. You
know, be at odds. So, I mean, we are different. Political differences we have had a long history of far more serious ones of people that, you know, having these splits. And unlike some wars, a civil war is often a war of ideas. And in this sense, I think the American Revolution was that.
You talk, and again, King George, and it just struck me as I was reading your book. I hope it's okay if I read just a bit from chapter four.
Yeah. What could be better?
the chapter four is Men of Moderation, and you say, the year 1760 seemed to hold great promise for Britain and her American colonies as the handsome 22-year-old ascended the British throne as George III, third of the Hanoverian kings. He became heir to his grandfather, George II, when his own father died suddenly at the age of 44. George III would be branded in America's founding documents as a tyrant. He was many things, but a tyrant he was not.
I always thought that was a bit extreme. Well, I think he ruled within the English Constitution. He ruled with the Parliament. He didn't overstep. But being a new monarch, he wanted to enforce the laws that had been in effect for a long time, the Navigation Acts and other taxes and restrictions on colonial trade. And the colonists had been, you know, quite happily ignoring these for a long time.
Right.
And there were a lot of very prominent smugglers like John Hancock, and smuggled goods cost less than ones that you had to buy legitimately, so people didn't mind. And in fact, it was very hard for the British to get an American jury to convict an American smuggler. So George III wanted to bring law and regulation to the American colonies, and so that was where he got on the bad side, and couldn't understand why the Americans were so ungrateful, you know, for all the things that the British had done for them.
And again, when you look at the different sides, I mean, again, I think that's the thing. And as I was reading, you know, in your book, I couldn't help, and maybe I should try not to do this, but I couldn't help but bring some of this stuff to the divisions today, you know?
Yeah.
The divisions then, the divisions now. And I think, you know, you've done a lot of work, Professor, in terms of the Second Amendment.
Yeah, talk about divisions.
I mean, you know, we're not a political show here. We're more of a body, mind, spirit, relationship, psychology type. But again, I couldn't help but think about.
And make the parallels.
And make the parallel to things like January the 6th. Mm. And, you know, and what we are in the midst of coming into this 2024 election, you know, the whole of the 2000s have been, when you look at it, man.
Yeah, I think most of us have family or members or friends with whom we do not want to talk about politics.
Mm-hmm. Oh, amen.
And I think that in, you know, in the American Revolutionary period for a long time, people could complain about what was going on, but there wasn't this sharp division. They didn't have to choose sides. It hadn't gotten to that.
Yeah.
So there's a sort of lesson. I mean, looking at it, I kept thinking that, you know, the extremists on both sides seem to get entrenched. You have the people that take over the colonies and, you know, the opposition loyalists, but the patriots. And they are not people to make accommodation, you know. And it's odd because Benjamin Franklin, after the Battle of Lexington, he went around the country and he didn't find anyone who wanted independence. So people really would have preferred to somehow make amends and you know, get some of their grievances sorted out and have a better way of doing things and use their local legislatures. But there were other people who were sort of driving the two sides apart. And so the opportunities to have some kind of reasonable reconciliation didn't happen.
That's such a tragedy, isn't it?
It really is. I mean, one of the lines that I particularly like was Thomas Jefferson and his draft, an early draft of the Declaration of Independence.
Yes.
When he says that we might have been a free and a great people together.
Yes.
That's the real poignancy, is that might have happened.
And again, I learned that from your book. I did not realize that was in the draft of Declaration of Independence.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's sad. I kind of feel that we are now a great and free people together, that the British are our allies and have been for some time. And there are lots of mixed marriages and friends and, you know, on all sides. But that it could have been avoided. And I think sometimes when you look back, I mean, the first real battle, Lexington and Concord, and then Bunker Hill, those were 1775, and we didn't declare our independence for a year.
Right.
Yeah. We didn't declare independence until 1776. So after a lot of bloodshed.
Yeah.
So there was a lot of hesitation about that move, you know, going on this uncharted sea of being, you know, independent from Britain.
If you want a book that is going to be hard for you to put down, so you've been warned, The Times That Try Men's Souls, out at your favorite bookseller right now, from Professor Joyce Lee Malcolm, also the author of The Tragedy of Benedict Arnold. She's our life strategist this evening here on Strategies for Living. And Jimmy, Lauren, let's go to the theater.
Let's head to the theater.
Yeah, to the theater.
I got our tickets.
Yeah, tomorrow night, Dial M for Murder. You know, it starts, Dial M for Murder is on stage starting tonight.
Mm-hmm.
And
you excited?
Yeah.
Excited.
I mean, you know, and our friend Stephen Parr from American Ground
AGR.
Radio.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
He is playing a prominent role here in Dial M for Murder. So you need to get your tickets. How do you do that? ShreveportLittleTheater.com. While you're there, go ahead and get your tickets for Jimmy Buffett's Escape to Margaritaville up in April. Of course, you know, Shreveport Little Theater, Life Magazine says it's one of the top three community theaters in the entire nation. And we say it's American theater at its best. I guess Life Magazine goes along with it. you know, so 812 Margaret Place in Shreveport is the place. ShreveportLittleTheater.com. You're going to see the difference. When you go to Azalea Cleaners, you'll hear about it too. Azalea Cleaners has been fine dry cleaning since 1958, plus laundry, alterations and repairs, comforters, wedding gown cleaning and restoration. You'll hear about it from your friends because they'll see it too. They'll notice the Azalea difference. Azalea is convenient. 732 Azalea Drive, 9220 Ellerby Road, and 9227 Mansfield Road, plus the front door of your home or business with Azalea's delivery on demand. Just text SETUP to 249-8283, and Azalea will pick up your clothes and deliver them back clean and fresh to you. You can't get closer than that. That's the Azalea difference. You'll notice it right away. Others will too. The Azalea difference. Fine dry cleaning since 1958. Text SETUP to 249-8283 and get the Azalea difference. AzaleaCleaners.com. And welcome back. Welcome back into 101.7 FM, 710 Kiel. Welcome back into Strategies for Living. Jimmy Bryant, I see you eyeing my book. You're not getting this book.
I am eyeing
no,
it.
No.
This feels like such a good read.
Yeah. Professor Joyce, he does this to me all the time.
Well, I guess you introduce him to the right books, right?
And then he fights me over them. Yeah. he's really tugging at this one. So that should tell us what a good book this is. The Times That Try Men's Soul, PLPC, Lauren Leon McMillan, David McMillan, Jimmy Bryant, and Professor Joyce Lee Malcolm. As you dove into the research, what was the biggest surprise for you?
That's a good question. Well, I was surprised at the sheer number of families that were divided but remained corresponding throughout the war and afterwards. I also was surprised to learn more about the people who went into exile, the so-called absentees. I mean, they weren't fighting. They were just seeking shelter, as it were, with what was then the enemy. But I didn't like to make any judgments, but I felt sorry for them because they had fled without any thought of how they were going to manage or how long they would be there.
Yeah.
And it was expensive. They ran out of money. They weren't used to it. They got together and met in little coffee shops. They did not fit into English society at all.
Yeah, they didn't fit any place. They fled here. They didn't fit there, and then they couldn't come back. Right. What a tragedy!
It was because in 1778, a couple of years into the war, the state by state banished these people. They were not allowed to come back. So here were people who thought they were only going to be away a few months or something, and they wanted to come back. They were banished, and if they came back without permission, they would be removed to some British territory. If they came back a second time, they would be executed. And while they were gone, their property was sold at auction. And Samuel Quincy, who had a fair amount of property, was pleading with his friends to save his law books. You know, if wanting your friends to buy some of what was going to go off at auction for you. So it was really, I found it very poignant. Mm. And Thomas Hutchinson, who was the governor, whose house had been stripped to the bone, he went to England. Actually, was recalled. And he had 25 people dependent on him. So how he managed, I don't know.
Wow.
And he wrote and said that he missed his humble cottage in Milton, and he said, on the whole, I'm more of a New England man than ever, and I will not despair of seeing my country and friends again, though I fear the time for it is further off than I imagined. So it was a pleasure to get at their letters, because you get a much more intimate look at how they felt. Than you would, by just sort of reading being at, 30,000 feet, looking at what was going on.
Let me take you to 1777, and I'm quoting from the book. In January of 1777, a betting man would have no doubt the British would win. They controlled New York City and Newport, Rhode Island. They threatened Philadelphia, causing the Congress to move to Baltimore, with serious threats in the South to Charleston and Savannah. But what was the unexpected turning point, Professor?
Well, what was the unexpected turning point was the American victory at...
We've got another
Saratoga.
Guest there.
I'm sorry about that. That's my dog, Darby. I don't know what...
Darby can help anytime Darby wants to.
Well... I wouldn't give him that opportunity. but the thing about it was that there was a big army and flotilla coming down from Canada trying to take Albany, New York, coming down through Lake Champlain and the Hudson. And a group got together. They quickly got a northern army together to oppose it. And Benjamin, Benedict Arnold was sent by Washington to help in the defense. But the man who was in charge of the defense, Gates, didn't like him. He didn't like Washington's protégés. Benedict Arnold was always telling me, you need to be more aggressive, we need more reinforcements. And Gates, who spent the whole of the battle in a tent where he couldn't even see the battlefield, and where he was discovered arguing with a wounded British officer who was dying about the merits of the revolution. And he actually confined Benedict Arnold to his tent. He stripped him of all command. And Arnold wouldn't stay there when this battle was going on. He said, if I go, I won't have any command, but the men that God bless them will follow me, which they did. He went racing off, and they followed him. And he discovered the right weak point in the British lines and led these men through it and got wounded in the process. But it was a real surprise. It was the first time when this large British army had been defeated. And after that, the French decided to sort of openly help the Americans.
Right.
And once the French did that, then it was not just the British against the Americans. It was really more a world war, because there were French colonies and British colonies everywhere. And the British couldn't concentrate so much just on their own North American colonies. So that really was a turning point. That it looked like it was really a going concern, and France was willing to come out openly. Of course, the fact they helped us led to their own revolution some years later.
Yeah.
But it was an important turning point, and Arnold was really instrumental in winning that battle.
The guns went silent. There was a couple of years of negotiation. The final treaty signed in Paris, October of 1783. What do we need to know about when the guns went silent?
Well, it took a long time to iron all of that out. The British decided not to be too harsh on us in the negotiations, because they didn't want us to fall under the supervision and control of the French of the French and the Spanish. So they were a bit more generous. Whereas their prime minister said, "I'd rather that the give the Americans their independence, because we can still trade with them, and that would be good." But there was a tremendous amount of sorting out afterwards. There was a general, Carleton, really a very fine general, who was put in charge of evacuating some 30,000 troops from America. There were troops stationed in Savannah. There was a lot of shipping and troops in New York. 30,000 troops, 27,000 loyalists. Now, these were people who had sort of taken shelter with the British and stayed in places like New York. There were African Americans who had fled to the British on the promise of freedom, and a lot of them were in New York in the harbor on the ships waiting to go into exile and be free. And the treaty had allowed for their former masters, if they could make a persuasive case that they had not been there very long, and had just escaped, to get them back. So there were a series of court hearings about this, with these people waiting to be able to leave and be free. So it was very dramatic and confusing and amazing that they were able to get all of those people away and sort of leave the Americans to their own devices.
I wish we had so much more time with you, Professor, but we don't. So, you folks, you got to get a copy of The Times That Try Men's Souls, Joyce Lee Malcolm. And we will be back here on Strategies for Living in just a moment. And welcome back. Welcome back into 101.7 FM, 710 Kiel. Welcome back into Strategies for Living. Jimmy Bryant, Lauren Leon McMillan, David McMillan, with our life strategist, Professor Joyce Lee Malcolm. The Times That Try Men's Souls. Professor, thank you so much for the work you're doing. And thank you. You're a great life strategist. You've been a great life strategist.
Well, I wish I could mend all the divisions that are in our country today. But it was really interesting to learn about these early ones. I love the research and writing, and I appreciate your having invited me to talk about it.
Well, we'll have you back. And in the meantime, folks, The Times That Try Men Sold, The Tragedy of Benedict Arnold, An American Life, Guns and Violence, To Keep and Bear Arms. Those are just a few of, she's been pretty prolific in her writing.
Yes.
So those are just a few of the titles that you can find from Joyce Lee Malcolm. So I hope that wherever you buy books, you'll go and get a copy of The Times That Try Men's Soul, as well as any of those other titles, because that's the deal. I mean, how do we, you know, why do we do history? Because we can look back and we can, again, do what we did today, connect, and hopefully we're learning lessons. Yeah, I hope we are.
Absolutely, all the time.
And hopefully wonderful professors like Joyce Lee Malcolm take us by the hand and give us our story. Folks, thank you. Thank you for tuning in to Strategies for a Living. Of course, we do this. It's our privilege to do it for you, and we can do it because of our wonderful sponsors, the Robinson Film Center and Azalea Cleaners and Pintail Roofing.
Roof, roof.
And Learning RX and Hempress, Cannabis with Love, and the Shreveport Little Theater. If today were the last day of your life, you only had one more phone call that you could make, well, who would you call? And what would you say? And why are you waiting? Make the call. For Jimmy Bryant, for Lauren Leon McMillan, for Professor Joyce Lee Malcolm, I'm David McMillan. See you next time right here on Strategies for Living. Professor Joyce, wonderful, wonderful, wonderful.
I enjoyed that. You really did look at that book.